started recording. Right?
Yeah.
So stop after 20 minutes.
Okay.
So you must press this red button on top again.
Okay.
Yeah? Sure?
Yeah.
So this will focus properly.
Just pay attention there.
मी पाडू नकोस मी स्वतःला सांगायला पाहिजे रेड बटन ना मी बसून
the first lecture on econometrics. Yeah? Now you, all of you have gone through a bridge course on basics of statistics. Right? So I'll start from there. I'll start with two important ideas today. One is the idea of a mathematical expectation. And other is a very important concept called the law of large numbers. The two important ideas that I will talk to you about. Is anybody aware of the concept of a mathematical expectation? What's a mathematical expectation of a random variable? Ever heard the term random variables? So what's a random variable? It's a, if you want to define a random variable, then it is a numeric valued outcome of a chance experiment. What's a chance experiment? A chance experiment is an experiment whose outcome cannot be predetermined, but is an outcome which depends upon chance. For example, if I toss a coin, then the coin can either end up heads or tails. If I am interested in the outcome on the uppermost face of the coin, then that outcome can be either a head or a tail. You can't predict beforehand whether it will be a head only or a tail. Right? So therefore you have something called a chance experiment whose outcome, right, in this case is a head or a tail. Right? Now this by itself doesn't qualify for the experiment, the outcome to be a random variable. A random variable is a numeric valued outcome of a chance experiment. What do I mean by numeric valued outcome of a chance experiment? Head and tail is not a numeric valued outcome. It's just a head or a tail. Right? But suppose we decide to play a game where if you have a head, you get 1 rupee, and if the outcome is a tail, you lose 1 rupee. So you pay me 1 rupee. Then your earnings will be +1 if the outcome is a head, -1 if the outcome is a tail. So what do you have? You have a chance experiment whose outcome is a head or tail, and if there is a head, you get a +1, if there is a tail, you get -1. So now, what you have is a genuine numeric valued outcome of a chance experiment. Such numeric valued outcomes of chance experiments are what are called random variables. Another example would be if I roll a die, then the outcome can be either 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 6. Right? I have a numeric valued outcome of a chance experiment. So in which case, the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 will be called random variables. Right? Now if I pick up any one student at random and ask that student his or her name, it's an outcome of a chance experiment because who gets picked up it depends upon chance. And the student then gives me his or her name. So the name that the student will give me will be an outcome of a chance experiment. But is it a random variable? Is that outcome a random variable? Is it or is it not? No. Why? It's not numeric value. But instead of asking the student what his name is, what his or her name is, if I ask the student what his or her weight is, then I have a numeric value outcome. right? So I have a random variable. If I pick up a student at random and ask the student what his or her roll number is, then I have a numeric value now. If I pick up a student at random and ask him, where do you live? The student said, Jogeshwari. Is that the random variable?
No.
It becomes a numeric value now. But if I ask a student, that student, what is the distance of your home from the campus, then what do I have? I have a random variable. So can you all give me some examples of random variables? Cards. So suppose I take a pack of cards and pick up a card at random. And if I say the card is spades, is it a random variable?
No.
But if I say it's 7, is it a random variable?
Yes.
It's a random variable. Right? Okay, so all of you understand the idea of a random variable fairly well. Now, why are random variables so important to us? Why do we as econometricians worry so much about random variables? They are going to be the objects that we are really going to try to understand. Right. Why is it so important for us to know random variables? Take the following problem. Suppose I want to know the average income of a person living in Mumbai. Yeah, I want to know the average income of a person living in Mumbai. Right? Now that number exists out there. It's a number eminently worthwhile knowing if you want to know how much does an average Mumbaiker earn. Right? So how will you find that number? So we have to find out the income of an average Mumbaiker in Mumbai. No, but you're not asking. No, you want the number or you want the income of an average Mumbaiker in Mumbai. It's a number, no? It exists out there. So how will you find that number? What would be the right way of finding that number? You have to go to each Mumbaiker, ask him how much do you earn, right? At the end, you'll have a large list of all Mumbai, all incomes of Mumbaikers, and then you sum all those numbers up and divide by the total number of people who live in Mumbai, and you'll get the average income of a Mumbaiker. But as you correctly said, you can't really do that. So the point is this number, is this number, the average income of a Mumbaiker, a random variable? It's not, no? Because if you have to again ask everybody in Mumbai the same question, assuming nothing changes, they will get the same answer. If you did this exercise once more again, if you went to every single Mumbaiker and asked every single Mumbaiker what's your income, right? And if nothing else had changed, they will always give you the same answers. So the answer you will get will always be the same. Right? Sure? Because you're going to ask the same, you're going to go to each and every Mumbaiker, ask them what their incomes are. Right? And nothing else is happening. So their incomes remain the same. The same set of Mumbaikers is there. So they'll give you the same answers. Right? And therefore, in the end, you'll get the same average number. Right? So this number will not change. Because it will not change, it's not an outcome of a random experiment. It's a real number out there. Right? It's a real unchanging quantity out there. Such a quantity we call a population parameter. Right? So what we have out there is a population parameter, and population parameters are not random variables. Right? They're not random variables because they will not change from experiment to experiment. Right? There will be a fixed number out there. There will be a fixed number out there. Right? Now the point is, and this is a number I want to know. I want to know what is the average income of a Mumbaiker, which is not a random variable, which is in fact a fixed population parameter. I want to know that number. But in reality, as some of you pointed out, you can't really know that number because such an exercise will be impossible to carry out in practice. In principle, it's possible to do that. But in practice, you simply cannot do that. Sure? And because you cannot do that, you take a shortcut, you take the next best option. You say, I cannot ask this question to all Mumbaikers. I will ask this question to a representative subset of Mumbaikers. As long as that subset is representative of all Mumbaikers, I'll ask them to a subset of Mumbaikers. So I choose, say, 1,000 such Mumbai curves at random. Get a sample, ensuring that this is actually quite representative of the mix of Mumbai curves, right? So 30% of the, say, suppose 70% of Mumbai curves are employed in the unorganized sector, 30% of the Mumbai curves work with banks. So I take a sample of, say, 1,000 people, where 700 of them will work in the unorganized sector, 300 of them will work in banks. So the proportions are maintained, right? Okay, it's called a stratified random sample. Right, so if I create such a sample, and on the basis of the sample, I ask each of these people in the sample what their incomes are. I obtain an answer from each of them. I get 1,000 answers. I average these 1,000 answers and divide by 1,000. I'll get a number, which is a sample estimate. This is based on a sample. Now the point is, this is indeed an outcome of a random experiment, because if I have to choose, if I have to do this experiment again, I choose a fresh sample. So the people in the sample will be different from those that were in the previous case, which means that their incomes are going to be different. So the answer that I'll get will be different. So each time I take a different sample of 1,000 people, I'll get a different answer. So the answer by sample estimate will indeed be an outcome of a chance experiment. It will be numeric valued output, right? It will vary from sample to sample. Therefore, the sample estimate which I get is a random variable. Whereas the population parameter that I want to know, but which I cannot know, is not a random variable, it's a fixed quantity. It's not an outcome of a chance experiment. Whereas the sample means will keep on changing from sample to sample, so there will be outcomes of a chance experiment. Therefore, they will be random variables. And the subject that we want to study essentially is about how to use these random variables, right, to say something about an unknown population parameter. The point is, I want to know, I'm not interested in these random variables. I'm not interested in the sample means per se. They're not of great interest to me. They're of interest to me only because they tell me what the population value is. They give me some idea of what the population value is. Because I can never know the population value directly, I can only know that from the sample estimates. So my only interest in the sample estimates is whatever information they contain about that population value. But as you know, the sample estimates will keep on changing from sample to sample. So therefore, I have to be very careful about, what I infer about the population value from the sample values, because the sample values will keep on changing from sample to sample. So
should the samples be similar in nature, or how do we
not necessarily, if I'm looking at the Mumbai city as a whole, all that I'm doing is I'm taking 700 people in my sample who work in the unorganized sector, 300 who work in the organized sector. And those people keep on changing sometimes.
But the next sample that is used, would you choose again those 700 or no?
Like, you not necessarily choose those 700. You choose, they might be chosen, they might not be chosen. If you are doing a sample with replacement, then out of the 1 crore, 1.5 crore Mumbaikers, one of these might appear again in the sample by chance. If you are choosing a sample without replacement, then we will say that these guys, aapka turn ho gaya, abhi aap nahi hai sample, maybe nahi log aayenge. But in each case, the sample mean will keep on changing. It may change, it might not change, but it will be an outcome of a chance experiment. Right? And the point is, the whole point is that I need to build a bridge between the random variables which I can understand, which I can measure, which I can get to know. From that, how to go to that unknown population parameter. On the basis of this information that I have, which is a sample means, how to make some educated guess about the population parameter which I am trying to say something about. The whole econometrics is essentially this whole science of how to go from random variables which you can know, which you can observe. So how to go from imperfect information, how to use imperfect information about unknown quantities to make reasonable good statements, reasonable useful statements about those unknown quantities is what econometrics is all about. Right? So it's therefore very closely related to a branch of statistics called inferential statistics. It is very, very closely related to the branch of statistics called inferential statistics. Whereas many of you have done in college a branch of statistics called descriptive statistics, where you learn to draw ogives and mean and median and mode. you know, you had measures of central tendency and all those kinds of things, right? Those are descriptive statistics, where if you have a set of data sets, how do you describe that data set? The problem now we are going to have is different. It says, how does one go from sample estimates, from imperfect information which can be observed, to say, make statements about quantities which I want to say something about, which I want to know but which I can never measure directly. Right? Okay, so the question that we are now going to have, the area of statistics that we are going to be interested in, is the area called inferential statistics. Sure? Right? And that's why econometrics will be rooted in that. So our whole objective will be how to use data to say something about population parameters that we want to estimate, that we're interested in, but which we can never observe directly, which we can only indirectly estimate. Right? That's going to be the game. Okay. Fine. So now let me start. That's going to be the whole idea really of the next 3-4 months that we're going to be here. Right? Okay. Now let me sort of introduce you the idea of a population estimate, a mathematical expectation, and a mean. Okay. So suppose now we are playing a game. The game is tossing the coin. Okay? And the game is like this. If the coin comes up heads, I give you 1 rupee. If the coin comes up tails, you give me 1. Right? And suppose we toss this coin 5 times. Okay? So let me write the sample space, the set of all outcomes. Let me write one particular realization of this experiment. So for the first time it was heads, the second time it was heads, the third time tails, the fourth time head, the fifth time tails. One possible realization of this experiment. Right? One possible realization of this experiment. There are many, many realizations of this experiment. How many realizations are there? How many possible outcomes can be there if I toss 5 coins? You see, this can be a head or a tail. So there are 2 possible outcomes here. This can be a head or a tail. 2 possible outcomes here. This can be a head or a tail. 2 possible outcomes here. Head or a tail. 2 possible outcomes. So you can have a head here and a tail here. You can have a head here and a head here. You can have a tail here and a head here. You can have a tail here and a tail here. So collectively the total number of outcomes are 2 into 2 if you are considering only 2 coins. If there are 5 coins, the total number of outcomes will be 2 into 2 into 2 into 2 into 2. 2 raised to 5. Right? So 2 raised to 5, in principle, 2 raised to 5 possible outcomes here. We are observing one of those outcomes. Right? Now given that we have got these 5 possible outcomes, if it's a head, suppose you get 1, so you got 1. It's a tail, you can get 1. Head, you get 1. It's a tail, you lose 1. Head 1 rupee, tail 1, right? So this is a sequence of your earnings. One possible sequence of your earnings, right? Which is 1, 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1. One possible realization of your earnings out of the 2 raised to 5 possible outcomes. Sure? Okay. Now, if I ask you a question, what is the average earnings? So what is 5 earnings? What's your total earnings now? How much have you earned?
1.
1, right? If I ask you, what is that 1 rupee? So your total earning on the 5 tosses is 1. Your total earning on all the 5 tosses is 1. If I ask you, what is your average earning per toss? How will you answer this question? Average earning per toss. What's your average earning per toss? Your total earnings from 5 tosses is 1. So your total marks you scored in 5 papers is 600. What is your number of marks per paper? 5 papers may have got 600 marks. The average marks per paper kitna hoga? 1. Right? So what did you do? You divided 600 by 5. Your total earnings on 5 tosses is 1.